Howdy folks, and welcome back to Let's Play Betrayal at Krondor, as brought to you by Jason. As per usual, we are just jumping on in here, and we are heading kind of southward, and finally making our way towards Krondor. We just finished off in what I assume is Quester's View here. Looking at my map, we actually missed a couple buildings, so we'll kind of turn back and see what those are. That's the weapon shop. This was our weapon fencer, dude. So what is this? There were stirrings inside the house. After a short time, a stout lad of about 13 came to the door, opening it wide. If you're looking for my brother, he's not here right now. Actually, no, Locklear replied. Are your parents about? The boy paused for a heartbeat. My folks were killed a year back. Mitch and I moved here several months ago to study swordplay with Tad Quester. We're gonna find the bloody brigands who did it and feed them their own hearts. Locklear was about to offer some fatherly advice about leaving such work to those older and more qualified, but seeing the boy's expression, he decided against it. Instead, he asked, Is Tad good with a sword? What? Are you kidding? He's the greatest. Lives right over there. The boy motioned towards Tad's house, then excused himself, closing the door behind him. Yeah, we already met Tad, kid, and we've trained under his wise tutelage. So what is this? Just a marker. Quester's View. Alright, hey guys, we found Quester's View. It's the inn. Yes. Where's the loot? Owen! Fortune smiled! Despite the fact that he was stumbling through the cords of this kingdom mine, Owen's lack of musical mastery was masked by the raucous noise of the tavern's drunken patrons thumping their mugs to the rhythm of the music. And we ended up making a whopping 15 sovereigns. Well, that partially paid off the amount of money we spent on trading. So it looks like we may have a dwarf over here, probably the barmaid, yeah. And, some other people. Interesting, like these two? It's like a finger, and this guy just says talks. Let's talk. Good day, said Locklear. Without turning his attention towards him, the man responded, I normally enjoy talking to travelers, but today I'd rather just enjoy my ale. Very well then, Locklear replied, heeding this man's wishes. Perhaps we will return at another time. Okay. I wonder if that's like a quest later in the game. Hey dude, I'm gonna poke you with my green hand. Locklear cleared his throat, glancing up from his business of cleaning his fingernails with a boot knife. The man regarded them frostily, motioning with the tip of his knife for them to quickly make their business known. It's a very nice knife, Keshin, isn't it? Locklear commented carefully. Where, by chance, did you purchase it? The man smiled, showing uneven brown teeth. Who said I bought it? Ah, Gorath said, taking hold of Owen's shirt sleeve. Well, I think my companion here promised me a drink before we came in, and I think it's well nigh time I collected on it. Good day to you. Perhaps we can speak again. All right. So that guy's probably a bandit. Hey, dwarf. The man scowled, apparently far more intent on something going on across the common room. He seemed uninterested in Locklear's repeated attempts to chat. At last, he glanced up and gave an exasperated sigh. What exactly do you want? Just a friendly little talk, Locklear said with a companionable smile. News, gossip, a song, perhaps. We'll go and find a bloody jongler, then, and leave me be. I've got better things to do than entertain every jackaboot that comes through that door. All right. Well, In that case, I guess we're done. And it looks like, all right, so yeah, there is an inn here. But, was there something I missed? Or was that was probably just the barmaid. All right. So Babin's Hostel is not the most friendly place in the world. And Owen, what's your barding up to? 50. You are a champion of barding. Perhaps I should have him focus solely on leveling his barding skill because I'm sure there's probably a way to abuse that and get like infinite money or something. Okay, so we went ahead in this direction. Although part of me is tempted to just follow the damn beach. I wonder if like we'll get, oh my God, I'm clicking everything except, everything except what I wanna click. I've been going too long, I'm slowly going insane. Let's just follow the beach down. Or not. Okay, it won't let me follow the beach. I suppose that's probably a good thing, because that is one ugly-ass looking beach. Like, that is kind of grating on the eye. A farmer was ahead of them, debating with a moment whether it would be more prudent to hide before they were seen or behave normally. Locklear decided the man was probably of no immediate threat to them.
It's a bad time for travel.
Wow, dude. You've been drinking a little there? I hope for your good health that you found shelter against the coming tempest, good sirs. Tempest? Surely you've heard. The lurking monks of Sarth have predicted a terrible storm is coming this way, and I would hate to think of anyone caught in it. My man could catch his death of the fevers. If you would like, you may ride it out in my barn. And what profit would you turn on this enterprise? 5 golden sovereigns, a reasonable sum, and the guard over my cows. You can sleep in the hayloft of my barn, but my wife and I don't take in elves. 7 gold pieces. The elf stays with us and we each get a hard roll for breakfast. 10 gold and the lot of you milk the cows the next morning. That's the offer, take it or leave it. I don't know, this guy... Like, who's to say he's not lying? That's the thing, is like... Like, we haven't met traveler-wise outside of that one dude at the very beginning of the game. Anybody that was, like, outwardly trying to help us. Fine. We'll take it. Deal. Where's this bond of yours? Keep heading south. You should pass the Abbey of Ishap at Sarth, and my email client will go off in the background because I'm an asshole and I forgot to mute my cell phone. From there, it's just around the Yellow Mule Mountain. When you find the bond, just go knock on the door and my wife will fix you up. Thank you, Fama. Your hospitality will be remembered. Alright. So, to the south. Oh, that's freaking handy! Oh, I gotta experiment. I just hit a button on my keypad and it opened the map. Oh my god! Best thing ever! Oh, maybe not. Oh, decidedly less entertaining. I thought it was hitting zero on my keypad. Would open, like, the minimap, like, this mode and close out of it, but instead it just clicks. It just does a left click. So that's less than helpful. Alright, so he told us where his barn is. We'll poke around a little bit. See if we can't maybe find some bandits or something out here to do violence again, because I'm good at that. I don't know. I like the combat system in this game a lot. It's just that the combat is, like, imminently lethal. What is this? It's a body. I don't believe we killed this one. Poisoned rations. Well, that's worrisome. What's a corpse doing out here that I didn't make? Oh, I don't know, guys. I don't know. What's down here? I'm going to bring up my mini-map. Oh, this is just an alternate path. Okay, well, we'll rest until morning. Not seeing any deadly storm, though. They were being watched. Ah! Knaves! Oh, and they got a wizard! I don't know what you just did, but I don't approve of it. I'm not gonna flame cast him, I'm gonna try and despair him and maybe shut him down. I'm gonna have Gorath rush him and Locklear can, you know, flail ineffectually like he does. Gorath, get up in that mage's grill. Owen! Run away! Do what you do. Okay. That's right, you freaking... Screw that mage's day up. Seriously, it's got an 80% chance to hit almost. I hate everything. Alright, so that guy's out of the picture, so I think, I'm just gonna let this one run. Because I wanna get this one engaged in melee. Oh my god, you fiend! Leave my squishies alone. Alright, mage is down. Yeah, this guy. This guy's gone. We're gonna have Owen run this way. And I'm gonna have Locklear just, I guess, come down here. All right. You see, I could be a real dick, I guess, and cast, like, I could pull him back to us with invitation. But I don't know how far that pulls. And I don't really wanna cast that at all. So I think we're just gonna have Owen camp there, and this guy is gonna get the shit beaten out of him. Yeah, that guy's done. He's had enough. Owen, continue resting. You guys just, oh, this guy's in. Owen, take a swing. Oh, you could have been great, Owen. What the hell was that, Locklear? Go all the way around. Locklear's defensive abilities have increased. Truly, he is a master of his craft. What do we have here? What does this mage have on him? A Mordhull brooch. Brooch. It's meant to be a cloak faster. Yaddy yaddy yaddy. Alright. It has 40 charges. Is that a two-hander? Oh. Oh, this pleases me. What else do we have here? A powder bag. Lockley untied the drawstrings held closed within the pouch and sifted through the ash-colored material within. Buried underneath was a slip of parchment on which had been shakily printed, "Throw into the face of victim, Lornus, Artificer of Planek." Palanank? Okay, so this is essentially pocket sand. We'll give that to Owen. And we have some rations. And what do we have here? An herbal pack. Those go to Owen as well, I believe. Well, that mage was certainly packing some interesting stuff. This guy's just got a whetstone. I'm actually really pleased about that two-handed sword, because not only is it another two-handed sword, but it's probably worth a bunch of money. Okay, I gotta do equipment maintenance, because I am ceaselessly forgetting. So what is this thing? Oh, okay, the 40 is its value. Alright, so that's just a treasure item. Okay, I thought it was like 40 charges. I had forgotten that meant like just gems and stuff. Oh, there's some armor training, like armor crafting and stuff. I had forgotten that just gems and stuff had a value system built into them. I wish they'd let me zoom out a little bit. I don't suppose I can. Oh, I can zoom out a little bit. That's super handy. Okay, so this is, I don't know where this barn is. Sarth. Oh, okay, so here's the next town, the next, like, menu town. The path turned after a few minutes of traveling. The roadbed began a steady rise. Jesus Christ, I cannot word. Spiraling around the base of a sheer rock-faced hill. Sarth, Locklear said. We probably have enough time to drop in for a brief visit, and it might break up the monotony of the road. Want to take a look around? Sure. Why not? Oh, wow. What is this, like a pyramid city? Oh, that's so cool! From a distance, the Abbey of Ishap at Sarth had seemed a fortress, its sheer-walled courtyard dominated by ancient single-story keep. But closer inspection revealed that a shop profited where once an ironmonger had forged swords. Delicate flowers bloomed where soldiers had once mustered. Oh, damn it, and I just hit exit because I'm an asshole. Back up into town, guys. Ah. Okay. Oh, this is... Like, you couldn't make it a little bit more... Wait, what was that? Did that say enter? So we have multiple things. We have, like, one entry point, another entry point, another entry point. So we have three entry points. Let's hit the shop. The Stardock Annex. Owen ogled as he picked through the assortment of magical items which had been laid out in the improvised store. Many of the items were marked by tags which indicated they had been sent from the Academy of Magic by Pug of Stardock. Alright, so Pug, I recognize that name. If I recall correctly, he's like the Mary Sue character from the books that this is based on. And I mentioned earlier that a friend of mine was really big on this series. The Riftwar, I think, books. It might have not. Whatever books this is based on, I knew at one time, but I'm too tired to recall the precise name right now. And I seem to recall him mentioning Pug a lot, and he always kind of struck me based on how he was mentioned as kind of a Mary Sue character. So, he's kind of like the Elminster of this, from what I gather. And we cannot just... Wow. Ooh, we have some spell scrolls. And restoratives. Oh, I'm gonna be spending money here. Will you buy this? 40 sovereigns, yeah, that's acceptable. I'm gonna keep my pocket sand. That's adventuring, that's just general stuff. Okay, what do we have? Does it tell me? Dragon's breath. Okay. Despair thy eyes, we know. Flame cast, we know. I'm glad we know that, considering it's a 400 gold piece scroll. Skyfire. Eyes of Ishap, we know. Night fingers. Nacre cicatrix. Okay. Skin of the dragon, so I assume that's a kind of a defensive buff. And thoughts like clouds. Well, I think I'm actually... Like, it's the cheapest damn one. Well, second cheapest, actually. I think we're gonna get dragon's breath. But now, accept. Alright, so can you go ahead and use that? Well, he could have wished for better circumstances under which to study it. Owen broke the scroll's wax seal and began to read. After an hour's laboring with a difficult language, he was able to commit the incantation to memory. And then the parchment grew brittle and slowly crumbled away. Alright, I'm also tempted to pick up like a shedload of restoratives. I do not want to use those. I just accidentally used one because I'm a jackass. No. Go into the shop. Buy. Yes. I don't want to buy too many of these. I think I want to buy like 15 of them. There. Because these are good for when Locklear inevitably gets pummeled into like near death and I use them to heal him. Okay, so we have shop. We do have a temple here, which I'm going to go ahead and memorize the... Oh, is there not one here? Strangely barren, as if the space had been prepared for decoration, which had not yet been crafted. Oh, I bet you that's going to be in later. It's another temple of Ishap. The abbot came quickly. A man of advancing years, his hair and beard seemed like a snowdrift, starkly in contrast to his dark skin, which was wrinkled like carefully crafted mahogany. Shaking Locklear's hand, he greeted them as if he had known them all their lives. Welcome to Ishap's Abbey, travelers. I am Father John. How may we be of assistance to you? We thought while we were passing through that we would come and visit the famous Abbey of Ishap at Sarth, Locklear said. You've done impressive things here. The abbot's eyes crinkled as he gave them a prideful glance. We hope to do more. We have only begun our work here. But thanks to Brother Anthony and Brother Mark, we have come a long way. Locklear bit his lip, hesitant to ask his question. Could we impose upon your hospitality a bit? We have a few questions. I would love to, though alas, I have services to attend at the moment. But if you have questions, Sarth is the place to come. We have books on many things, and if you seek out Brother Mark, he can help you with a good many other questions. Good day to you. Alright, so Brother Mark, so if I talk again, will that just throw me into the same thing? Yes. Alright, so how do I find Brother Mark? Yeah, that's the cold fire. Alright, so let's enter here. Alright, so we have a library. We have trees whipped at their faces, mumbling about the inconvenience of castle engineers. Owen led the way down the fur-covered slope, arriving at the mouth of a large cave. Oh, really? Told you I wasn't mad, he muttered. Looks like a cave mouth. Want to look inside? No. Alright. And then, what is this? Alright, another. I think this is the same library? Yes. A supernatural silence reigned in the vaults under Sarth. A perfect stillness that was unbroken, even when a priest would accidentally let fall a book while searching the shelves, or when someone would sneeze while opening a dusty volume. It was as if time itself had frozen here, trapped between the wooden cases, like pages within a book. Alright. So, it looks like we've got a bunch of stuff we can kind of peek at, so I guess we're just going to start on the right. The book concerned magic. Snatching the closest volume at hand, Owen began scanning the pages, hoping to find a grammary of spells from which he could learn. Flipping pages, he was nearly oblivious to the priest who had marched down the aisle and snatched the volume from his hands, politely replacing it from where it had came. These books are restricted, the priest said sternly. Long ago, we learned the wisdom of making sure an initiate has some training before embarking on our reading magical art. Before reading our magical themas. I've had some training, Owen began, but was silenced by a hard look from the priest. You're more than welcome to visit our other collections, but this is restricted, the priest said, his tone indicative that he would tolerate no argument. I am sorry. Okay. Healer's journals litter the shelf, but by far the most extensive collection within Sarth's impressive stack of books, Locklear felt a little intimidated. Unsure what titles or names would be of the most use to him, he picked up a book at random and began to read. Unfortunately, much of the book he had selected was confusing or contradictory, and after struggling with it for nearly half an hour, he finally gave up, putting it back on the shelf where he had found it. Next book, he thought. Okay, so is that... like, is this all the same? Yes, okay. Oh, shit. Seriously? Or is that... Okay, so this is actually two different things right here. Oh, that's tricksy. Okay, random book. Or maybe not. Maybe it's just random. Okay. Of particular interest, he came across a book because... he came across a book that was of particular interest because it had actually been written within the walls of Sarth. The book was designed as a quick manual to instruct the reader on how to deal with critically injured. Immediately as may be performed, the injured party should be conveyed to the locality of an inn or other place. They may spend the night out of the night's humors. Once bedded, it is advised that they be administered 4 dosages of restoratives and an herbal treatment. Provided they are left undisturbed for a period of 3 days, the chances are reasonable that they recover from their near-dead condition. Alright, so in that case, this might be actually some mechanical knowledge here. I'm going to go ahead and write this down in my notes. 4 dosages of restoratives plus herbal treatment equals... cure near dead, maybe. Because we don't know how accurate the books are. Alright, so let's check this one out. Owen scowled. The books arrayed before him all concerned theories on finance, a subject which his father had long ago exhaustively bored him with. Well, he thought he would never again be interested in the subject, he found himself reaching for one of the volumes. A pitiful remnant of what was once a wonderfully scribed book, numerous pages appeared to have been ripped out whole, leaving only the ragged remains at the edges. Disheartened, Locklear glanced quickly at what was now the top page before closing and returning it to the shelf. Many make the mistake of believing that a general goods store will offer the best prices on jewels. In practice, it is by far better to sell to a store that has emeralds, diamonds, and rubies on display. Kind of common sense. Okay. And this is the same. Wait. Like, it's just a simple ledger. Yeah, so this time he opens one and it's a simple ledger containing only row upon row of numbers, which didn't seem to add up properly in his head when he ran his finger across the column. Closing it with a snap of his wrist, he replaced it on the shelf. Okay. We're here. Gorath smiled. Pleased to find something in the vaults which appealed to his interest, he thumbed through a book which apparently had something to do with combat techniques. Gorath scoffed as he began to read, realizing the author had little or no idea about the actuality of fighting hand-to-hand. Disgusted with it, he shoved the work summarily back in the slot from which he had pulled it. Examining the shelf full of volumes, he muttered to himself, "There must be another book here more helpful than that one." Well, let's find out. Well, I'll just click the same one a couple times and see. Nope. What about this? The shelves were overburdened. Massive books, which all appear to be older than anything Locklear could imagine, most of the works in the section appear to be concerned with a theology or philosophy. Not as well versed in the history of the gods as he would like, he reached for a less intimidating looking volume and began to read. One of literally hundreds of books on the subject of Aishap, the god above all, the book was difficult to understand and written in a barely legible hand. Setting it aside, he looked back at the other books on the shelves. Okay. Oh. How about here? Alright, here we go. So this is a new one. What do we have? The shelves were overburdened. Less intimidating looking book. Oh my god. It's like throwing me random stuff here is kind of frustrating. Having expected by the title to find a book about Dala, the protector goddess, he was surprised to find that within seemed to be the registry of names of people who regularly attended services at the temple. Also included was a special page, which seemed to be a proclamation made by the priests of the temple of Dala. Henceforth, let it be claimed. Blessed of Dala be the daughters of Flendel Halfgate, so named Thea Andrea, Gina, Sarah, Kira, and Larissa, who in good mercy hath right worthy and truth to the goddess, provided much needed leather goods, grain, and entertainment for the woefully poor in the hour of need. From this day in the second year in the reign of good King Lion the First, forever shall you issue be watched over by the fortunes of the goddess. And I actually saw a third one in there. The contents of this book, on Sung, a god of purity and healing, were relatively light and easy to read. Though it told little that he didn't already know about the Temple of Sung and its tenets, before closing it, he did take special heed of the fact it implied that the Temple of Sung offered more extensive healing powers than those offered by any other temple. Good to know. And that looks like about it in here. So we're gonna go ahead and exit, and I'm going to... I guess we're gonna check out this cave! Sure. They made their way into the blackness. I'm gonna immediately open the minimap because I'm a jackass. But oh god, what is this? This is episode 11, I think? I'm fairly certain 11 is. Yes, episode 1. You damn fucking... I hate games. Like, these old games, they're like, my computer has a numpad. Let me use the damn thing. Remove game. Yes. Alright, save it as 11. Rabble, rabble. Anyways, let's poke around and see what we got. I have a new bit of death magic that I'm kind of curious to test out here. Candle glow, and we'll cast it at... we'll just go ahead and cast it at 10. Oh my god, and you immediately start whining about needing sleep, you assholes. Fine. There. I immediately recast. Candleglass, what is this? Oh, so Dransmith just creates fog. And it seems to be a non-combat spell. Interesting. Alright. I'm curious what benefit that has. Maybe it makes it easier for us to sneak up on things. That could prove useful. Water dripping sound effects. Locked tight. Think we can take a shot at opening? Yes! Locklear! You're a failure and I hate you. Come on. Ugh. That's like your one thing that you're good at. Well, and you're not even really that good at it. I don't know. You're going down a tunnel. It goes left, it goes forward, and it goes right. Let's go right because it looks like a shorter way. At least we can see the walls here. All right. Another locked door. Aha! Okay, well there goes his lockpicking skill increasing. I'll take it. And there's, what the hell are those? Luckily, those aren't doors. They're scorpions? Luckily heard a sound. Knowing they were about to be attacked, he planted his boots. God damn it, I'm going in to try and see what they are. It looks like giant scorpions. Yo, dog, I heard you like giant ass freaking. Scorpions. Alright. Go ahead and. Okay, so these things seem to be like really accurate and incredibly hard to tell like where they are exactly. So this one, okay, so this one is actually adjacent to Owen, even though it looks like it's taking up like four spaces. Right, thankfully, they look fairly easy to hit. Where is this thing? Oh, I think he just killed that one. Yeah, it's not moving. All right. Man, Gorath is just imminently lethal in melee combat. He does so much damage compared to Locklear. Is it dead? No. Okay, still moving. Now it's dead. As Owen, I would imagine, just runs around screeching at a pitch that no human should make. Okay, let's go ahead and beat this thing down. Oh, come on, you guys! I'm just gonna let it eat you, Owen. The rest of the party can't keep up. Alright, there we go. Giant scorpions and abilities have increased. His abilities always increase after fighting giant scorpions. His accuracy is 70. He should like never be missing. Okay. I see a chest, if nothing else. And yeah, a bunch of dead scorpions. A couple chests by the look of things. Do they have loot? No. Okay, that doesn't surprise me. I mean, they're giant scorpions. What are they gonna be carrying around? This isn't a Final Fantasy game. So let's go ahead and get our chest protection spell here. I keep wanting to call it Trap Zap. And I don't know why. Oh, it's a Mordhall box, alright. A box beneath a tree inside some tasty meat. Kept for a month or more, it still tastes just as sweet. Is this seriously a walnut? Oh my god. All right. I got one, guys. What did it get me? Lewin's Concentrate. Owen had observed magicians carrying vials of the same fluid almost always downing a concoction before setting to work casting incantations. For a brief period of time, the imbiber would be intensely focused, ignorant of events outside of his purpose. Okay. And we have a shell with a 59 quality, which is exciting. So what I'm gonna do is... You're not gonna give me a more info button, alas. Okay, so what's this guy? It is trapped. Ooh. We are not going to mess with this because the last time I tried to do that, half the party got like almost killed. So I'm gonna be a coward and we'll leave the loot there. Because thus far, you know, we're doing good. And I think. All right. Check down one more tunnel here, see what's what, and then I'm gonna call it. Is there, oh, there's a door. Is it locked? Of course it's locked. Locklear, I hate you. Ah, there we go. The mechanism inside wasn't hopeless. It broke! I hate you, Locklear. Try another key or try to pick it, and you can't. No. I suppose you can keep trying by any chance. Luckily, I'm so disappointed in you right now. Like, I'm not even mad. I'm just disappointed. Oh, did we just go in a big damn circle? Or should they let you move the map around? I think we went in a big circle. Luckily, he disappeared up the stairs. He returned a minute later, shaking his head. Oh, this leads up to a series of complicated mine tunnels, or maybe a passage to the library vaults through there, but without a map or some directions, we would never find our way through. Here I was thinking this maybe led to that collapsed tunnel that we found. What was it, last episode? Alright, so I'm gonna limp us back to this intersection, and that'll be where we call it. Which I think should be, like, right about here-ish? Coming up? Yes, okay. So, I'm going to camp until everybody's healed, and an extra hour, just because. I'm gonna recast my light spell. Wherever it is. There we go. Cast that level 10. Okay, I'm gonna save, and we're gonna haul it. So, as per usual, folks, thank you for watching. I hope you had a good time. And I will catch you all next time, where the adventure continues. Until then.